Hello, good looking. What you got cooking?
We got some stories that we've been cooking on for a little bit here.
Yep. Season 1, Episode 7?
The Andorian Incident.
Mm-hmm.
This is another choice by Al. He's been piloting this ship of discovery.
Yeah.
And he's been making good choices. He's been making real good choices. So, run down the plot real quick for those at home that haven't seen anything going on with the goings-on of a certain pointy-eared people.
Okay, so basically what's happening in this episode is the crew of the Enterprise is, they're out there in space. They want to do some stuff, you know, they have the free rein pretty much to do what they want.
Yeah, Starfleet's giving them the go-ahead to, you know, explore those strange new worlds.
Yeah, and so they see this one planet or moon or whatever it is that says, hey, it says there's a monastery here, a Vulcan monastery.
Well, no, the planet didn't initially show up on the star charts.
Yeah.
And you know, T'Pol seems to know something a little bit about it.
Yeah.
And she says, well, there's a monastery there.
Yeah, let's go visit.
Yeah, let's go say hello.
Yeah, let's go say hello. What they don't know is just basically a few hours previous, the monastery had been taken over by a group of people called the Andorians.
Well, I'm doing one. They got two.
Okay, and the Andorians are there because they believe this planet is not a monastery at all. They think it's basically a spy outpost, a listening outpost.
Yeah, at the very least, a lot of traffic of knowledge is coming through here that is against a treaty that the Vulcans had against the Andorians.
Yeah.
And they're still very suspicious to the point where they keep hassling the monks and stuff at this monastery pretty regularly.
Yeah, they show up every now and then.
Yeah, just to shake them down and see if they can see what comes out,
basically. And the monks are basically saying, no, this is just a place of contemplation.
Yeah, planet Pajem, or the moon Pajem,
mm-hmm.
Which really is a sacred place to them.
Yeah, but this time the Andorians actually take over the place. They're really serious about finding evidence of basically breaking your treaty.
Yeah, under the leadership of a War Admiral Shran,
mm-hmm.
played by the admirable actor Jeffrey Combs.
Not Jeremy Coons.
Not Jeremy Coons, but Jeffrey Combs, who has popped up in Star Trek pretty much everything Next Generation beyond.
Yeah.
He's
yeah.
a prodigious Star Trek actor.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he turns in some of his best work as the suspicious Shran.
Yeah.
And what is he looking for? What does he do?
So basically the crew of the Enterprise show up. They beam down to the planet and they're taken captive by the Andorians. And the whole episode is basically them in captivity trying to find a way to get out.
Yeah, get a signal to Enterprise. Find a way to bring down the shield that that Pajem has over it, which is they claim is to protect the sanctity of this religious site for Vulcans. Mm-hmm. But really, there's deeper goings on that.
Yeah, because later in the episode, it's revealed that the Andorian suspicion that this is basically a listening outpost is confirmed. This is a listening outpost. They have a really
one hell of a spaceship.
One hell of a spaceship down there, locked in the basement, basically.
Yeah,
because you know it's.
And that's where you get to interesting points.
Yeah.
In this episode, like talking points about what we believe Vulcans to be.
Yeah.
And as somebody that before Enterprise, like you have the original series, Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, Voyager, it was kind of believed that the Vulcans are always on the level.
Yeah.
You know, it's one of the tenets of their beliefs is Vulcans don't lie.
Hmm.
And boy, what a lie! not only that, but it's
and that you know that's the real thing about this episode is the Vulcans technically aren't lying. Technically, the star charts they gave Captain Archer and the crew are accurate to a point.
They're missing information.
Yeah, they're not...
They're not lying. What we've given you is true.
Yeah, but they haven't given you the whole truth.
Yeah, and that comes down to the question is the whole truth what you want, or is a half-truth good enough?
Mm-hmm.
And when you talk about this episode, it brings up the points of humans' innate mistrust of the Vulcans because they believe they've been holding things back, which is kind of true.
Yeah.
The Vulcans do know warp technology that goes beyond warp 5.
Mm-hmm.
Why are you letting us muddle around in warp 5 when you guys have warp 7?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's one point. We can let that slide.
You know, another reason I chose this episode to talk about is we have 3 of the 4 founding members of the Federation.
Yes.
Species-wise.
So it's the humans, the Vulcans, the Andorians, and the Tellarites.
Yeah, we haven't seen those yet.
Not yet. They'll pop up very soon. But it also shows the tensions in the Alpha Quadrant.
Mm-hmm.
Even though these people have known each other for decades
anyway,
at the very least decades, I'd say the Andorian Vulcan relationship goes back about 100-150 years.
Mm-hmm.
And they've never sorted it out. They never had a first contact like humans had with Vulcans. And that's the other side of the coin. Like humans, this episode brings it to a point. Is humans always believed they were being held back by the Vulcans. There was a section of humanity that believed that. And then the Andorians were the other side that said, we know you guys are withholding things.
And they're right.
And that's the big twist, is they're right. And guess who it shakes to its core?
Who's that?
T'Pol.
Mm.
It's a great episode for her. I fell in love with Jolene Blaylock.
She's her, mine. Stay away from her.
I saw her first. but when you have a character that, from the outset, is so, I guess, groomed to believe in the Vulcan set of ideals and their thought processes and stuff, and when it's revealed that what she was taught was a lie, you know, it's as if she was believing in Santa Claus wholeheartedly, and that was revealed to her at age 80 that it wasn't true.
Okay.
It shakes her to the core.
Yeah. Yeah.
It brings to light several concepts for me.
Okay. What? Like what?
One is, at this point in time, the Vulcan species, as it was written in the original Star Trek, was during a Cold War era.
Mm.
And the Vulcans are in a Cold War. This has come up through the writings of several of the authors of episodes, producers, directors, and stuff, is that the Vulcans are in a Cold War with themselves. And that they are at odds with the idea of them being a galactic power, yet still holding to these ideals of truth and honesty.
Mm.
And when your scope opens up, you have to ask hard questions of yourself. Is it worth sharing information? Is it worth being completely honest with everybody? Especially when you're dealing with hot-headed species like the Andorians. Mm-hmm. Even the Tellarites are pretty aggressive.
Yeah.
Humans are the best case scenario for the Vulcans.
They're grooming the humans.
Yeah, we're being groomed because we are the newest species to the...
and
the
we'll
warp
listen.
Community. Yeah, we will, and we have.
Mm-hmm.
And without their help, we wouldn't have gotten out here.
Mm-hmm.
In as respectable and honest a fashion as possible. But with these incidents of the Vulcans using a sacred site to
as
cover
basically a shield.
Yeah, a shield that would deter most rational or not rational, but emotional or generous people.
Mm-hmm.
That is a crime into and of itself. Is, wow, how deep can this Vulcan mistrust go? And even T'Pol starts to see it.
Yeah, you know, what I took from this episode was the Vulcans and the Andorians have a treaty.
Yeah.
That, it's basically a non-aggression treaty.
Yeah, it's like a ceasefire. They fought in the past.
They fought, and what I took is that you have to honor your treaties with other people.
If you make an agreement with somebody to either do or not do something...
Because the Vulcans, at the end of this episode, have been caught red-handed.
Red-handed.
The information that is so damning to their side has been revealed by Captain Archer. He allowed the Andorians to take the information that they learned back to their command.
And I loved that scene. I loved that scene because it proved the quality of humanity.
Hmm.
And not necessarily humanity, but Archer. And if this is the vessel that's going to be the beacon of humanity sent out into the dark depths...
He has to do it.
He has to act this way.
Mm-hmm.
And to Paul, despite her decades of experience, you know, dealing with interstellar species and as a woman of science,
mm-hmm.
logic and reason said, I have to let Archer let them know about this.
Yeah.
She said, take all the scans you need. That was, for a Vulcan, that's a powerful line.
Yeah.
Is, yes, you are right, I was wrong. Mm-hmm. She will never admit it, but that's not her mistake to admit.
Yeah.
But Vulcans don't feel emotion, but that is as close to as shame as I've seen on a face of a Vulcan.
Yeah, yeah.
And, masterful performance by Jolene Blaylock.
She's still mine.
I saw her first. But all in all, I'd say this is one of those great episodes.
Mm-hmm.
Not only because it tells a compelling story about, like, hostage situations and we gotta find a way to sneak the team in to get people out. It's a thrilling and great and clever episode with great acting, but it really enriches the Star Trek mythos.
Yeah, these are the very early shaky, very shaky beginnings of the Federation.
And it's I think that's the keynote of what it means to run like the Federation of Planets.
Yeah.
Is it's always shaky. There's always so many considerations you have. You have religion, you have economics, you have, you know, just pure manpower, technological advancement, mm-hmm. sharing, negotiations, and contact, communication. It's, that is one thin knife to walk.
Yeah, yeah.
And if this is the first misstep, the Vulcans landed right on their crotch on that knife.
Yeah, this is the first time the Vulcans have really had basically a chink in their armor.
Yeah, they've shown ultimate weakness and ultimate, not necessarily paranoia, but they want to keep tabs on as many cookie jars as they can find.
Yeah, and they're actually, this is the first time that they're kind of unable to do so. They're not up to the challenge.
Yeah, their supposed dominance has shown weakness to the point where, there's almost a bridging bond between the Andorians and humans.
Yeah.
And if things had gone differently, you could see them being almost the analogous, like the analogy is the Andorians are militaristic. Humans are coming out of World War III militaristic.
Mm-hmm.
If the Vulcans had met the Andorians, the humans would have been the Andorians.
Yeah.
But it's all about who you meet first and who you make friends with. And how do you keep these promises with friends?
Yeah.
And I think that's a core tenet of Starfleet.
Mm-hmm.
Is honor your friendships, honor what you say, and do your best to complete what you promise to do. Or what you say you're going to do.
Yeah.
And props to Archer.
Yeah.
Cheers to the man.
Hey.
Because... guess what?
Here's to the buns.
The buns. But, no. Another shining example of, in my mind, which is which is growing on this rewatch of Enterprise. One of the best captains.
Yes, the guy's a hero.
Through and through, he's brave.
This guy is a total idealist, Captain Archer. He stands up for moral reasons. Very completely,
and he's willing to fight for them, too.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
he'll die for an ideal.
Because it's kind of his belief set is he isn't the best of the captains, mm-hmm. in his mind. Mm-hmm. He believes in humanity, is I can die, I can give myself to a cause, because there will be 10 people behind me,
mm-hmm.
that believe the same as I do. And that's Starfleet, is there are no weaklings, because everyone supports everyone and everyone believes in each other.
Mm-hmm.
And he will take these risks.
It's true, but you know, we're getting really ahead of ourselves. The Federation doesn't exist.
No, at this point.
But this episode is important because it sets the groundwork, because be like, okay, you know, the three of our species, you know, we reach a certain level of mastery. We're basically being held back by the Vulcans. But now, after this point, that we realize the Vulcans have been doing all this stuff, we, through their shame, we can each approach the table
with a little bit more
equality.
Yeah. Equality and a little bit less restrictions. We don't have to worry about certain things because this moment has contracted, much like a puckering asshole, the Vulcans' confidence.
That little clenched sphincter.
Yes. But they aren't the all-encompassing lords of the Alpha Quadrant.
No.
And this really knocked them down a peg. And this is going to be interesting going forward.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to this.
Because an incident like this doesn't go unnoticed.
No.
And it does come up again in future episodes.
Mm.
So, from me and Al, I hope you guys can come and see the next step, because I know he's going to choose another great episode. It's just faded.
Good night, everybody.
So, yeah, good night, and...
Mm-hmm.
We hope you trek yourself before
you wreck yourself.